discussion on sampling and then review, begin our review of probability theory. Right? Okay, so let's recap what we learned yesterday. I think the main message that we learned yesterday is the on the sampling theorem, which essentially states that if a continuous time signal has a maximum frequency of f max, or if you have a sinusoid of single frequency f, then we should choose our minimum sampling frequency as 2 times that, right? So, if you recall yesterday, what we discussed is the main reason for the sampling theorem is, the recommendation of the sampling theorem is based on this phenomenon of aliasing, right? And why does aliasing occur? So you have to ask this question one after the other. So why is there a sampling theorem? What happens if I do not follow the sampling theorem? If I sample lower than what is recommended, then I run into aliasing. And what is aliasing? Well, aliasing is essentially this phenomenon where a high frequency discrete time sine wave maps back to a low frequency sine wave. So as we went through the example yesterday, suppose I have a sine wave of frequency 1.25 cycles per sample, then we know that mathematically this would be indistinguishable from this other frequency. There is no way you would be ever able to figure out whether it is sine 2 pi, whether it is a frequency 1.25 or 0.25. That is again because of the periodic nature of the sine waves and the fact that you are looking at a discrete time signal. That's the most important thing. These are the 2 things. So when you sample a signal, right, like the one example that we looked at yesterday, when you sample a signal, let's say of 10 hertz at a frequency of 8 hertz, I made the corrections now. You end up with a discrete time sine wave of frequency 1.25, which then manifests as 0.25. So I asked you to generate this sine wave, right, in MATLAB as a simple homework. We can do that. In fact, although it's mathematically obvious, let's actually do this as a very simple example. So here, 2 into pi times 1.25, let's generate about 20 observations of the sine wave. What's the periodicity of the sine wave? What happened? What is the periodicity? It's so tough. Why 8? What is f here? It takes this long to determine the period. 1 million. 1 by 10. What is that? This is exactly what I have been saying that you should never do for a discrete time sine wave. How can you say it is 1 over f? We have gone through this discussion, if you recall, a few weeks ago, that for discrete time sine waves, the period cannot be determined by 1 over f. But if you want to do it that way, I cannot help it. How do you determine the period? Why is it so intriguing to you this morning? Oh, come on. So represented as a fraction. First of all, you are not paying attention to the units. discrete time signal, you are looking at the period, if you call it as NP, it is the number of samples taken to complete, you know, taken for completing, not, well, ideally one cycle, right? Ideally one cycle, but then you have to find the nearest, maybe that's what you meant by integral multiple, for completing a few cycles if necessary, that the first few cycles. Ideally, it is the number of samples taken for completing one cycle. And in this case, the number of samples taken to complete one cycle, that's where your 1 over f thing comes in. But there is nothing like 0.8 samples. But instead of going over that kind of calculation, you just write it as 5 by 4. So, 5 cycles are completed in 4 samples. That's how you read the units. We have gone through this discussion, again I'm saying. And the point is, you express f in the most simplest rational form, such that the denominator and numerator are coprimes. So that now you know, as far as an observer, from an observer's viewpoint, you will see the first repetition of the signal after 4 samples. You will not be able to say how many cycles have been completed. That's the difference between a continuous time sine wave and a discrete time sine wave. The fundamental period is only going to tell you after how many samples a repetition will occur. But within that period, how many cycles have actually occurred, you will not know unless you do a Fourier analysis. If you do a Fourier analysis, then you will start with the fundamental frequency 1 over 4, then 2 over 4, 3 over 4, you will include all harmonics, and then you will figure out that yes, this is the frequency, right? Any questions on this? I'm going to ask this question again at a later time, and hopefully at that time all of you should be clear with this. The concept is extremely simple. Only if you pay attention to the fact that the period of a discrete time sine wave is no longer a continuous valued quantity. It's a number of samples, and it's not a monster that's going to gobble you up. It's just, after all, a very simple concept. You don't have to be scared of it. Okay? Be bold, be brave. Nothing can eat you up. Fine. So, let's get back to the discussion. Now, what I wanted to show here is that although this is a very high frequency, I mean 1.25, right? Now, high frequency in the context of discrete time signals. Let's generate. Another sine wave which has a frequency of 0.25 and plot one on top of the other, right? So let's do that. What we have, then let's plot a stem. Let's clear. So, I'll maximize the plot. So, here is your first sine wave, and then let's plot the second sine wave with a red color and dashed line style. Oops, I think I made a mistake. Okay. So, this is how these two signals look like. If I had used the same color, would you be able to distinguish it? This is a very easy question. You don't have to think much. I don't know. Are you all able to see, or you want me to increase the line width of this? Is the figure clear to the people at the back? what you can see is that these two sine waves are indistinguishable. As I said, had I used the same color for both sine waves, there is no way you would have known that there are two signals there. Right? You want me to zoom in and show? I'm sorry? You are not able to see two colors. Actually, that is the problem. I'll show you here. Let me see if I can zoom in and show you. There is a red and a blue which I can see on my screen, but no way. So that itself goes to show that they are indistinguishable. Okay. But I can see a blue tincture there to the red. All right. Maybe what I could do, now you can see, no. So the best way to do this, alright, let us try drawing a dot plot, dotted line, and maybe I can have a line. Again you can't see. That itself shows that these two are aliases of each other. Okay? Well, of course, what I could have done is actually have a line width of 4 for the other plot. Maybe that's a last ditch effort. Now the blue has dominated. Right? The red has gone missing. So you can play around with this. But the fact is they are indistinguishable. I mean, we know it mathematically. I just want to show you. So what happens is, although you have a 10 hertz signal being sampled at 8 hertz, which results in 1.25 cycles per sample, you as an observer will always see 0.25. Okay. In fact, I am not proving through these plots that you will see 0.25. What you should actually do is to prove to yourself, you will have to generate the signal, do a Fourier analysis, and see for yourself that Fourier analysis tells you it's actually there is only 0.25 frequency there. What I have shown you instead is that these two are indistinguishable. So it's an indirect way of proving that you will see 0.25. Okay. Now, going back to our discussion on sampling theorem, because of this aliasing phenomenon, what we have is that, when we want to reconstruct the continuous time signal, I have an issue, because what this signal will manifest as is a frequency of 0.25. So for all working purposes, xk has this frequency, which means the corresponding, when I try to reconstruct, I will end up with a 2 hertz continuous time signal, which is not the signal that I actually sampled, right? So this has occurred because I have not sampled fast enough. That is one way of looking at it, but that's only half of the story. The main culprit or the main reason is the fact that discrete time sine waves are unique only in the interval minus 0.5 to 0.5. This is called a fundamental frequency range, as I keep saying. So as long as you sample your signal such that the frequency of the discrete time sine wave or cosine, doesn't matter, falls within this fundamental frequency range, you will be able to recover the signal correctly. If you sample in such a way that you have a situation like this, then there is a map outside, that is all the frequencies outside, there is an alias here, so it maps back, and it's also called folding. There is another technical term in sampling called folding. So it just folds to a low frequency signal, and that is what you will be able to recover. That means you have lost the information. Okay. So you have to remember that the main reason behind having this sampling theorem is because of the nature of the discrete time sine waves. Okay. Now, we'll have about 5 or 7 minutes discussion on some practical considerations and then move on. As I said, in reality, you are not going to have signals with a single frequency. You are going to have signals with mixed frequencies. In which case, your sampling frequency is going to be based on the maximum frequency, obviously. Because if you have fulfilled the condition for the maximum frequency, you have fulfilled the condition for the all the other frequencies lower than that, right? So, as an example here, this is the example that we looked at yesterday. Here I have 3 frequencies in XT and the maximum is 50 hertz. Therefore, the minimum sampling frequency is 100 hertz. Now, the question that should come to your mind is, in practice, how do I know what's the maximum frequency? Before even I sample, who will come and tell me what is the maximum frequency? Because that is what I do not know. That's what my experiment is going to tell me, perhaps. So, how do I decide my sampling frequency? It's a catch-22 problem. Correct? Now, there are at least 2 different remedies to this. One is you choose a very high sampling frequency, hoping that you have taken care of the maximum frequency in the sine wave. Okay? And of course, your choice of sampling frequency is also limited by the hardware. But today, you know, many good hardware give you quite a large bandwidth for sampling frequencies. That's not an issue. But that can also run into the risk of aliasing if your choice of sampling frequency is not meeting the highest frequency that you expect to see. In industry and in many practical applications, what you do is you force the continuous time signal to have a maximum frequency of what you want. And this is achieved by using what are known as anti-aliasing filters. So, what you do is, you let x of t pass through a filter, analog filter. What is the role of this analog filter? It's going to clip the maximum frequency. It's going to make sure that the filtered signal will not have a frequency beyond what you specify. Now, having assured that, you can choose your sampling frequency. How do you decide what should be the cutoff frequency in the analog filter? Well, that varies from process to process. So, if you know that a priori you will not never expect to see frequencies beyond 500 hertz, right? Or anything above 500 hertz will be noise only. And there is nothing that you will that will come from the process. Then you choose 500 hertz, just as an example. And then you choose your sampling frequency to be 1000 hertz. Now, practically, you will choose more than the minimum. And that's for an obvious reason. Suppose you are not using an anti-aliasing filter. You are just using a sampling frequency. And you are basing it with respect to some maximum frequency that you think you expect to see. Then you may be in for a surprise if you just stick to the minimum. So, practically you set much higher than the minimum, but how high? Can I actually go to 1,000,000 hertz? Is that good? Is that recommended? Is the next question. Should I choose as high as possible? Because intuitively what we feel is that higher the sampling frequency, better, closer I am to the continuous time signal, correct? But is it a good thing to do? Now, unfortunately, that is not a great thing to do because there is always going to be some noise. And when your signal is not changing much with respect to the sampling frequency and you just sample very fast, yes, in the sample signal you will see some variation, but most of that variation is going to be due to noise. And your algorithm may not be able to distinguish necessarily between the process variation and the noise. So, you are unnecessarily overloading your signal processing, signal processor or your estimator. You don't want to overburden. The classic example that I always give is news channels. when they broadcast news. Typically, news does not occur. I mean, what we call as news, what we think of news, interesting news doesn't get generated as at the rate at which the channels want it to. Sometimes there can be sponsored news, that's different. But what the channels ideally like to have is news being generated every second, so that they can keep the viewers hooked to the television channel. So fortunately, news doesn't get generated as fast as they want it. So what do you see? Some event happens, so they're all hungry for some event, and some event happens, and then a lot of noise is made out of that event. So you invite some 10 people, and then you ask, what do you think, somebody would like to know, or you may say, well, what do you think? Do you think that this cockroach died because of heavy winds, or and so on? I mean, anything is an event, and then noise is made out of it. If you are listening to the television and you are a first timer, you think, boy, there is a lot of news happening in the world. Only later you realize most of it was nuisance, not news. Okay. So if you are unable to, if it's a gruesome event that they are discussing, that anything is discussed, and if you happen to be a heart patient, then the consequences can be disastrous. Okay. In fact, many people do die because they keep watching these emotional things and gruesome things time again and again and again, because the screen is split into two halves and you're being showing the same event again and again. So the moral of the story is, don't sample unnecessarily fast, because you're going to bring in noise than anything else. And that is where there are some practical guidelines when it comes to choosing the sampling rate. Before I go to that, I just want to remind you that for any choice of sampling frequency, as I said yesterday, if you are to ask what is the maximum frequency that you can recover unambiguously, that is obviously FS by 2, because then that meets the sampling theorem criterion. And this frequency, FS by 2, is known as the Nyquist frequency. And also, if you want to have a perfect reconstruction, which we won't use this in the course, but just for your own information, if you want to ideally recover the continuous time signal from its samples, then Shannon gave this reconstruction formula, which, as you can see, requires infinitely long samples. The summation runs from minus infinity to infinity, and it also requires, therefore, future values. So therefore, it's a non-causal reconstructor, but nevertheless, it says, if you give me the full sampled signal, I will be able to recover x of t exactly, provided the sampling theorem conditions is met. Whereas a zero order hold, how does it reconstruct? Very simple, no complicated formula. Any signal that you give, it says the continuous time signal is simply a piecewise constant signal, piecewise constant over the sampling interval. And we know that it is exact for continuous time signals that are piecewise constant over the sampling interval. So let's now talk of practical considerations. When you sample fast, two things can occur. One, that you can bring in a lot of noise, right? And two, recall the eigenvalue mapping theorem that we had. We said lambda of the continuous time system maps to e to the lambda I Ts, right? So if if Fs is very high, then Ts is very low, which means e to the lambda I Ts is pushed to 1, right? When we say low relative to lambda, and that means you are pushing the pole close to unit circle. And that's not a good thing in system identification, because if you have poles close to unit circle, let's say you have a pole at 0.995, because you have sampled very fast. How do you explain this pole being pushed to unit circle and the fast sampling rate One way is to use this formula and show that the pole goes to 1. What is the other way of looking at it? Intuitively, if you were to explain without using the pole concept. What does the pole at 1 mean with respect to the difference equation? For the difference equation, suppose I have a difference equation description and I say that this system has a pole at unit circle. What does it tell you about the difference equation? That's one way of looking at it, but correct. So how do you write the difference equation for the integrator? Suppose I have a single pole and that's, let's say, exactly at the unit circle. How does the difference equation look like? Plus or minus? Correct. Equals UK. Okay, some input, right? So that's good. So if there is a pole at 1 or even at 0.995, you can say approximately YK is YK minus 1 plus UK. It tells me that two successive values are identical. Suppose I take away the input. Suppose the input is an impulse or it stops acting after a while. Two successive values are going to be identical or nearly identical. But that is what fast sampling rate would mean for a very slow process. Suppose I am watching the movement of a snail and I am watching every millisecond. What do you observe of the position? Between two successive instants, it won't change much. Correct? That amounts to saying that you have a pole close to unit circle. Which means over for a large number of data points, you will have a constant signal. Yet, this noise will actually make it look like as if it is changing. But the fact is that the underlying truth has not changed. And that can confuse your estimation algorithm. And you can prove that these are called ill-conditioned systems when it comes to estimation, that very small errors in your algorithm can result in estimates of poles outside the unit circle. Which means, although the system is stable theoretically, you may end up with an unstable model, which you don't want. So these are the things that you have to watch out for when you are sampling very fast. This is unfortunately a fact that one has to live with when it comes to sampling. When you have a system, and in fact it becomes even more pronounced when you have what is known as a multi-scale system or a stiff system. You must have heard of stiff systems, right? What is stiff system? When you have, do you remember what a stiff system is? Do you recall? In ODEs, numerical integration. Anyone? What is a stiff system? It looks like most of you are in Shivadhyana today. Being Mahashivaratri, you don't want to be perturbed. There are many who are already preparing for the night meditation. Lord Shiva won't mind you answering, I can assure you that. So what's a stiff system? What is a stiff system? Oh, come on, you can answer. Let's handpick Prem. This is not a sponsored question. What is a stiff system? Reshmi? Sorry? That's all. Because it's very stiff.
The slopes are very...
No, that's not a way to describe a stiff system. Come on. What about you, man? What is the stiff system that you encounter in numerical integration and so on? Do you recall what you have heard this name stiff system in the first place? It's got to do with a bunch of ODEs, right? which have really differing eigenvalues. Right? There is one ODE which has an eigenvalue, that means time constant, that's very high. And there is another ODE of the same system which has very low eigenvalue. And these two are a part of the same system. It's like having a snail and a rocket in the same system, right? A snail and a rat. Why is it so difficult to deal with this set of ODEs? I have to integrate them jointly. What is the difficulty that you envisage? The main issue is step size. Very good, right? If I choose a fast step size, then I will find the slow moving one very annoying, because it just doesn't move. The solution doesn't change at all. On the other hand, if I choose small step size, what happens? I would have missed out the dynamics of the fast subsystem. I would have irritated that guy. So one of these is going to be irritated, right? And that is the major challenge. What is the relation between step size and sampling interval? They are more or less the same. When we talk of numerical integration, we use the term step size. That is the times at which I wish to observe the solution, calculate the solution. Sampling interval is no different. Sampling interval is the time that I take to observe the next instant of the next value of the continuous time signal. So you should now grow beyond, I mean, you should see the analogies between the step size in numerical integration and choice of sampling interval in signal processing. They are one and the same. The issues are the same. We may use a different terminology, the stiff systems and step size, and here we may say multi-scale systems and sampling interval, but the story is the same, the challenge is the same. In fact, ideas from the solution to stiff systems are borrowed in multi-scale analysis. So if you look at Simulink, and if you ever open Solver, if you want to set the solver for Simulink, you must first know that Simulink uses numerical integration. Do you know that? If you are simulating a continuous time process, like the liquid level system that we simulated, it uses a numerical integration method. And if you go to the solvers, when you go to the configuration, it will bring up a list of solvers, ODE23, ODE45, ODE45S, and so on. That ODE45S is a special algorithm meant to handle stiff systems. So you need to know all of this to be able to do a good job. Anyway, so bringing you back to the point of discussion, choice of sampling rate is can be a big challenge for many applications. But the guidelines are that if you choose very fast sampling rates, and fast is relative to the dynamics, then you can, one, bring in a lot of noise unnecessarily, two, you may end up pushing the poles of the full system or the subsystem, depending on the system, close to the unit circle. This is unfortunately a fact that one has to live with when it comes to discrete time systems. So let me close by giving you a rule of thumb that is generally followed when it comes to choosing the sampling interval. Suppose I model the system as a first order, just to give you an example. Suppose I think of the system as a first order with time constant tau, then the general guideline for choosing sampling interval is that it should be anywhere between 1/5 to 1/10 of the time constant, which means that we want to have at least about 20 to 40 observations or samples in a single settling time. For those of you who are not familiar with linear systems theory, settling time of a continuous time, first order continuous time process, is roughly 4 tau to 5 tau. So when I say that I'll choose 1/5, for example, 1/5 of time constant as a sampling interval, that means in one time constant, I'm obtaining 5 observations, right? And that means in one settling time, I'm obtaining roughly 25 observations, if you assume settling time to be 5 tau. And likewise, you have 40 or 45. So this is a rough guideline based on experience. You can choose higher than this, you can choose smaller than this, but then you should be prepared to face the difficulties that you may run into. Okay, and I've already spoken about the anti-aliasing filter. So this brings a close to the discussion on sampling, discretization, where we have learnt some very important concepts as to how the continuous time and discrete time system that we look at, or a sample data system, how they map and what is the connection between these two. And the key parameter is a sampling interval. And then we have discussed how to choose this sampling interval, both from a theoretical and practical viewpoint. And this not only brings us to the close of sampling and discretization, but also brings a close to the discussion on the theory of LTI deterministic systems.